Hello, my name is Pedro. I was born in January 1884. All my life I had worked in the countryside, but as I had no land, when industrialization developed, I decided to try my luck and working as an industrial worker in the city of Barcelona. I looked for a job, and I found one in electric company La Canadiense in April 1902.
My workmates and I worked 10 hours per day, all days of the week, and we received a very low salary in exchange of our work. Some weeks later, I realized that some of my workmates had anarchist ideas, but I didn't understand why they were against the monarchy. But although our ideas were different, we got on well, and some days after work, we met in the tavern, where we had a drink. Most of my workmates drank a lot, until they were intoxicated, but I didn't want to spend all my money in alcoholic drinks. Becoming aware of social inequality, I felt very bad, because only few people had a very luxurious life, while most of the people lived in poverty.
In May, Alfonso XIII became King of Spain. The political system of the Restoration went on, but the dynastic parties had some difficulties due to changes in society, like the increase in the urban population, because industrialization increased the number of industrial workers, so it was more difficult for them to manipulate the elections in the cities.
For example, in Catalonia, the Liga Regionalista broke up the dynastic throne in Barcelona in 1905, despite all the electoral manipulations. Besides, the influence of the opposition parties, like the Republicans, increased. One of the parties with more popular support was the Radical Party, led by Alejandro Lerroux.
Some months later, my wife Maria came with our children Luis, Andrés, Juana, Dolores, Daniel, Rafael and Carmen to Barcelona. She found a job in a textile industry because what I earned wasn't enough to survive. What I didn't understand in those days was why my wife received a too low salary. I looked for a school where my children could study, so they wouldn't be illiterate as my wife and me.
Some politicians of the dynastic parties, like Antonio Maura from the Conservative Party and José Canalejas from the Liberal Party, tried to make reforms from above to avoid a revolution from below. But these reforms didn't improve the workers' life too much. My family and I only ate cereals, usually bread and oatmeal porridge. And very few days in a month we could eat meat, vegetables, fish or fruits. Besides, our living conditions continued to be very bad. The room I had rented was small and it was located in a marginal and unhealthy neighborhood. There weren't sewers and the rubbish accumulated in the streets. I was really worried about my children because of the risk of contracting an illness.
Antonio Maura was the Prime Minister from 1903 to 1905 and from 1907 to 1909. His reforms were stopped by the Tragic Week, which was the first big crisis of the Restoration under Alfonso XIII's rule, and it took place in 1909. This is what happened.
After the Conference of Algeciras in 1906, Spain received a protectorate in the north part of Morocco, the Rift region. There were minerals there, and the army considered the Rift as a good way of recovering the prestige lost in 1898. But the Berber tribes of the Rift opposed the Spanish occupation and fought against their troops. In July 1909, the tribes defeated the Spanish troops in the Barranco del Lobo, Wolf's Gully.
The Spanish government decided to send more troops to Morocco and they called reservists of Barcelona, including me. But we didn't agree with that and we started a strike in which we built barricades and burned some religious buildings. The government had to send the army to suffocate the revolt.
After a week, there were more than 2,000 arrested and some sentenced to death. I was lucky, but one of the persons who most defeated the workers, Francisco Ferrer y Guardia, an anarchist pedagogue, was executed. This provoked a general protest against the government. The king dismissed Maura and the liberals formed a new government. The Radical Party, partially responsible for the revolt in Barcelona, lost support of the workers. The Republicans and Socialists went together to the elections, and Pablo Iglesias, the first Socialist deputy, was elected in 1910, and the anarchists decided to create a union, the CNT.
My workmates convinced me to go to a CNT meeting. They spoke about the bad working condition of workers and their purposes to improve them. I liked their ideas, because I thought that families like mine deserve a better life, so I joined the CNT. I explained my wife the anarchist ideas, and although it was difficult, I convinced her to go to a night school to learn to write, read, and speak properly.
José Canalejas from the Liberal Party ruled between 1910 and 1912. He tried to make some reforms, like reducing the power of the church and making conscription more equalitarian, but he was killed in 1912 by the anarchist Manuel Pardiña Serrano. I didn't agree with what this anarchist did, because I think that violence doesn't solve anything. After that, the conservatives came back to power.
In 1914, the Great War started in Europe. Spain didn't participate in it, but it sold products to both functions at war, so export increased and deficit reduced. Rich people became richer, but this also provoked negative effects in Spain because protests and prices increased, but not the salary. My family and I went through hard times to make ends meet, so my eldest children had to leave school and start working.
The 1917 crisis was the second critical moment under Alphonse XIII's reign. There was a triple protest, but the three groups of protests weren't coordinated. The military protested because of the loss of purchasing power and the promotion system, which benefited the military designated in Morocco. The government decided to close the Cortes. The opposition politicians responded to the closure of the Cortes with a call to a deputies assembly in Barcelona, asking for constituent Cortes. Only 10% of the deputies went to Barcelona, and the government dissolved the meeting pacifically. The CNT and the UGT, a socialist union, called for a general strike, but the government dissolved it by using force.
The government controlled the situation, but instability became constant. Governments didn't last much. The dynastic turn was definitely broken. The constitution was constantly suspended and concentration governments were formed.
After the Great War, Europe restricted imports, so the production of the Spanish trade decreased and it didn't recover until the end of the 20s.
In December 1918, I received a letter from my brother-in-law. He didn't know how to write, but his son, who had gone to the school, wrote on his behalf. He explained that the life in the countryside had been very hard since I moved to Barcelona. The owners of the land didn't give work, or they obliged their workers to work more than 10 hours per day, from sunrise to sunset. His family suffered hardship. I told him about the improvements we were achieving, but he refused this idea because he thought that unions were violent and that they only caused trouble to workers.
That same year, my little daughter became ill. She started having fever and feeling weak. We didn't have money to take her to the doctor. But when the fever went up, we looked for a Czech doctor. Unfortunately, he said to us that she had the Spanish flu and that she would die in a few days. The flu took my child Dolores' lives. My family and I were very sad.
The news of the Bolshevik Revolution in Russia made the workers lose fear, and there were protests in all Spain, especially in Andalusia and Catalonia. In Andalusia, workers who didn't own land occupied lands for 3 years, but the government repressed the protest. In Catalonia, the industrial workers went on a strike to improve our working conditions. From 1918, the CNT had increased its influence due to a crisis in the Catalan industry, so many industrial workers joined it.
In 1919, the workers of my company, the electric company that supplied the industries of Barcelona, the Canadiense, went on strike. It was a 44-day general strike, which paralyzed much of the industry of Catalonia. The CNT had an important role in the development of the Canadian strike. With this strike, we achieved that the government issued the 8 working hours decree, the first law limiting the working day to 8 hours.
But our patrons, who were frightened, answered with lockouts and hired gunmen to threat the members of the unions. This was called pistolerismo, and anarchist leaders as Salvador Seguí, Pau Sabater, and their lawyer Francesc Layret were killed. Tension increased and street confrontations became usual in Barcelona. In 1921, 3 anarchists killed the conservative Prime Minister Eduardo Dato in Madrid.
Also, in 1921, the Spanish troops were defeated again in Morocco in the disaster of Annual. More than 12,000 soldiers died as a consequence of an imprudence of the general in charge, Fernández Silvestre. The Cortes ordered an investigation to clarify the responsibilities, and the Picasso report showed the implication of the king in the disaster.
Partly, in order to avoid the publication of the report, a coup d'etat was prepared and Miguel Primo de Rivera, the Captain General of Catalonia, rose against the government in October 1923. He got the support of the king, the businessman and the conservative groups, and only the anarchists and the Communist Party created in 1921 opposed it. Primo de Rivera imposed a dictatorship which lasted 7 years, from 1923 to 1930. It had 2 stages.
The first stage was the military directory. It took place from 1923 to 1925. This government was only formed by military men. They suspended the constitution and the elections, dissolved the parliament, forbade all the political parties, and established a strict censorship. They also forbade the Catalan flag and anthem, restricted the Catalan language to private area, and banned the CNT. Primo de Rivera re-established public order with a rigid control of the opposition unions, but he also wanted to end with the old way of doing politics, caciquismo, and a regime party was created, the Patriotic Union, but the old caciques were replaced by new ones. He had more success in the solution of the problem in Morocco with the cooperation of France. The landing of Alhucemas in September 1925 allowed Primo de Rivera to control the Spanish protectorate in Morocco.
The second stage was the Civil Directory. It took place from 1926 to 1930. Primo de Rivera included some civilians in the government and tried to perpetuate his dictatorship. Drawing inspiration from the fascist Italy's economic policy, some national monopolies were created, like Telefonica and CAMSA. The state promoted public works and followed an autarkic economic policy. This consisted in reducing imports and producing all the country needed. But the economic crisis of 1929 hit the country and the opposition started reorganizing. In January 1930, the dictators resigned and the king appointed General Dámaso Berenguer as president of the government.
This period was called the dicta blanda, soft dictatorship, because the opposition didn't have much trouble to meet. In August 1930, the Republican parties, the Socialists and the Catalanists signed the Pact of San Sebastián, an agreement to overthrow the monarchy of Alphonse XIII, create a provisional government and call elections to constituent cortes. Berenguer resigned in January 1931 and he was replaced by Admiral Juan Bautista Aznar, who called for municipal elections on the 12th April. The Republican parties won in 42 of the 50 capitals of provinces. On the 14th April, when the results were known, the Republic was proclaimed in different cities. A crowd in the streets of Madrid received the signatories of the Pact of San Sebastián. The king suspended his power and exiled in Italy.
My family and I hoped that the Second Republic would give us a better life, but this is another story.